When my love stands next to your love.
There was a huge buzz on the Talking Heads. In fact, Joey Ramone was the first person to tell me about them. And I went down at CB's, and I'm standing out there, and all of a sudden I hear, when my love stands next to your love, you know, and I said, what is this? This music was so hypnotic. I was being sucked into the room. Then I ran up after they were over. They had no crew, they had nothing. And I helped Tina, this beautiful young girl, you know, take the stuff off the stage. I said, you have to be on my label.
'77 is actually a landmark year for CBGB. The punk scene gets a lot of attention. Not only the local press, the New York press or the American press, but the world press came to CBGB right away. We had as many as 600 people inside CBGB for Ramon's show. Somehow, you used to see like two or three layers of people. People standing on the ground, then people standing on chairs, and people standing on the railings. So it's like, you know, the Barry is on fire.
1977 is a seminal year. It opened up a whole new world of music to people, and it opened the eyes of an industry that needed the new Elvis. And then comes along this collection of people in this small venue, and they're creating change.
There was some party, and we drove over to Studio 54, and we all climbed out, and they wouldn't let us in. That was where it was Debbie, Harry, it was me. You know, you think they'd let Blondie in, you know?
I never went to Studio 54 that much. It was all about, you know, rich people. Bianca Jagger and all that stupid crap. The Velvet Rope Syndrome just became the norm after a while. You know, we tended to stay downtown.
I guess we're just interested to see what's going on.
It's a fascinating place, I must say. It's probably one of the most interesting places in New York.
The CBGB's, like, it's getting worse because, like, there's a lot of people coming here who aren't the right kind of people, you know? And, like, not the old crowd, like, the new crowd. You can't
say no. 77 at CBGB's, the bands were complete opposite reactions to the disco period, the studios, 54s and that stuff, but once everything got going, it just became pop music all over again. I mean, the Ramones, Talking Heads, Blondie, Richard Hell, I think they got better with their commercialization. You know, it became a business. And for record companies, their job is to be in business. This was a time when the British were getting involved in coming over and seeing what was going on at CBGB's and then feeding it back with their own take on it.
The Sex Pistols were getting unbelievable attention in Britain because everyone found them so shocking, and they went on the Bill Grundy show and said the word fuck. And then they did their tour of the U.S., you know, Sid Vicious was getting beat up, and there was always blood, and this is what the press grabbed onto, and this is what became known as punk rock.
There was a lot of trepidation in the American music industry, and in the radio, we had to really sell ourselves, and a lot of it just had to do with their expectations of what punk was, you know.
Punk had bad connotations. So I tried to come up with a different phrase than punk. And because New York had been rather dormant in the years before all this action started taking place on the Bowery, I called it the New Wave.
One way or another, I'm gonna find ya. I'm gonna get ya, get ya, get ya, get ya one way.
I remember hearing some of our music on the radio for the first time. It was a thrill, and there were lots of moments like that. One of the songs was a hit, or hearing one of the songs went number one or something like that. With all, you know, all these high points.
Debbie, she had a great commercial voice. Then I remember them saying, you're really going to be amazed when you see us on stage at Madison Square Garden. And I was thinking, okay, I know I like this, but I wasn't thinking that. And sure enough, they got there, you know. Blondie had it. The Talking Heads are another real example. The most imaginative, interesting music played by people whose imaginations at the time even exceeded their ability to execute it, but it didn't matter, and they made hit records.
We had just finished our best album, Rocket to Russia, and we went on tour. We thought this was gonna be the record to break us.
We do two European tours, 151 shows is what I call the beginning of the non-stop world tour.
We did an incredible show in Stockholm, Sweden, where the audience tore out the first two rows of seats. And when I heard that, I said, oh my God, you know, we're getting famous.
1977 was a fabulous year for Sire Records because we were in the right place at the right time. It just got better and better and better.
This is not just a fluke. This place on the Bowery called CBGB's continues, you know? By the end of 1977, punk rock took off around the world, you know?
If you go to the Bronx or even the West Side, the Lower East Side, half of Brooklyn, buildings that were abandoned by landlords in 1977 are now yuppie condos with the views that are selling for hundreds of thousands, if not millions of dollars.
Living in New York now, you feel safe. The city is cleaner than it's ever been, but it feels a little bit dull.
It's Indianapolis is all it is. There's no life to this. I want to see whores on 42nd Street. I had enough of this. People coming in from the...
You don't even know what a whore looks like.
From the suburbs. From the suburbs to see the Lion King.
I like the city better when it was sleazy. I don't think big cities should be safe for women and children and families. It's just not good for the arts, you know? It all becomes fucking real estate after a while.
You know, these bands at the local bars would be playing, you know, Smoke on the Water, you know, Deep Purple, who were selling out the New Haven Coliseum of 20,000 people. So it seemed so big and massive that you couldn't start anywhere, you know? So it really distracts me when you do that stuff.
Pick this
Sorry. As soon as you break eye contact, you're the worst fucking interviewer I've ever met in my life. Because if I ever broke eye contact, as soon as you break eye contact, I think you're disinterested.
Oh, yeah, I'm sorry.
I don't ever want to do another interview with you again, because you're breaking eye contact. I like to talk to somebody.
Yeah.
You know?
Okay, fair enough. I was trying to grab some additional stuff, but...
I would never fucking break eye contact with a subject, because they'll tell you better stuff, and you're like playing with everything in the fucking world.
Okay, let's take a break.